Okay, so hi, if you don't know me, I'm Dr. Alex Jones. I am one of the AI team leads here at Riverside Research, and today I'm going to be talking to you about this real-time data fusion demo that we've done on AWS for our BrainLink approach for tracking multimodal activity and nuance framework, otherwise known as Batman, that I'll be going over some slides here showing a brief overview of what Batman is and then what the demo is going to be showing today. And then I will actually launch into the demo and then show you what's running on AWS for us. So a big problem that people have in the intelligence world is that when it comes to multimodal geospatial intelligence data, there is a lot of data coming in from a lot of different places all the time, constantly. It's a lot of fire hoses that you have to ingest data from many different directions, and it makes it really hard to figure out what might actually be going on. So, you know, there's often only so many people that you can have that look at this type of data on a day-to-day basis, and you can kind of help compensate for a lack of manpower with artificial intelligence and machine learning. You can use this to automate your detection of different types of anomalies that might be occurring within the data, to pick up on patterns of life, on what things might be doing. And it might not fully solve and automate the entire pipeline in terms of the most difficult behaviors, but it can definitely get rid of a lot of low-hanging fruit that might be really monotonous to get through. So the whole purpose of this artificial intelligence is to not entirely replace the analysts, but instead to make them a lot more productive and give them a lot more comprehensive insight onto what actually might be occurring throughout the world. So the application space that we talk about here with Batman historically has been maritime, but it can easily be expanded into other domains such as aircraft or mobile devices or spacecraft or anything that really basically has something that you can track, whether it's got useful IDs on it, like an MMSI number, or useless IDs where it's just like some sort of various track or target number. So this is just a very general overview of Batman. So it ingests various different types of detections from different data sources. So we're dealing with here often detections that have already been made through, you know, picking out, you know, here's a bunch of ships from satellite imagery, or here's something that's picked up in acoustic data or RF geolocation data or AIS data. That being said, we can also do detections within data ourselves if people ever need us to. It just requires development time to build the algorithms to do so. But you take all those detections and then you fuse them in with a bunch of different modalities of all the other data to try and detect, hey, I've seen targets here in this modality, and then it tries to cross-reference what those detections might be to try and create more comprehensive tracks to try and say, okay, you know, this acoustic detection was in fact this ship that I saw in the satellite image here. And then it takes all those targets or ships, whatever you're tracking, and then it puts them into a giant ship log where it integrates it with a bunch of other contextual data to give you context on what's going on in the environment around it. So that could be like if there's any protected marine environments nearby, what exclusive economic zone are those ships in, what's the weather like around your target? You know, is there any air pollution in the area, looking at things like NASA live stream data? Or like, you know, are there any relevant, you know, structures nearby like gas and oil pipelines? And then Batman then takes that log of all that fused data together and then runs an artificial intelligence against all of it to do behavioral classification on, in the maritime application, things like loitering, illegal fishing, docked, wandering, which is basically where, you know, a cargo ship would go out of a normal like path of traffic, or things like transshipment or things trying to tamper with gas or oil pipelines. The demo that we're going to show today is going to primarily focus on the first part of this pipeline in a real-time setting. So the purpose of the demo that's going to be shown today is going to show how we can synthetically generate multimodal geoint data of various types of targets, in this case ships, and then utilize them in a real-time environment within the cloud to then set us up to do development, to do pattern of life behavior on these targets. And this could be something like a mission application where you're trying to figure out something very quickly on what could this thing be doing at this point in time, or you can tangentially trace it into something a lot more longer term to say, hey, this is a type of repeated behavior that I see this type of target doing over a longer period of time, which could indicate then a greater behavior that could occur in the future. This demo is going to then show the data being synthetically generated. It's then going to show how that data is then ingested into AWS using Kinesis, which is a tool within AWS to do asynchronous data ingests. And then it's going to take that data that's been ingested and do real-time data fusion on it. And then after that data fusion has been done on it, you can then display it in a heavy AI front-end tool for like an analyst to see. So I'm going to go ahead and swap over to the demo now. So the overview for the demo is going to be, we have an AWS setup that's fairly straightforward. We have an EC2 instance, which is basically just a computer that's running constantly in the cloud that you can just remote log into. And we have a bunch of Python code on that EC2 instance that is going to generate a bunch of the live stream synthetic target data. And once again, these are just detections of these targets. We're not actually generating like raw SAR imagery or anything like that. We're generating entries in a table that says, hey, I detected a ship in this SAR image here. I detected, an RF geolocation of a walkie-talkie from a ship here. And then here's, maybe a stream of AIS data from another ship. And that data is going to be dumped into an Amazon AWS Kinesis endpoint that is then going to asynchronously ingest all of that data and constantly stream it into an Amazon S3 storage bucket. And then as that data comes in, we have a Lambda function, which if you don't know what a Lambda function is in AWS, it is basically a serverless application that can trigger off of different types of S3 events, such as data arriving at the bucket. So whenever data arrives at the bucket, the Lambda function will automatically trigger and perform a data fusion process on that data and then immediately dump the fused data back into the bucket. Once it's in the bucket, you can then update your heavy AI front-end instance, which will then pull that data out from the S3 bucket and into its display tool so an analyst can then see it in as close to real time as possible. So when it comes to the synthetic data generator, here's just a very broad overview of what that does. So the behaviors that we generate within the tool itself utilize basically a giant graph that represents the world, at least in the maritime domain. So we have a graph that has a bunch of nodes on it that exist every X amount of kilometers. We can adjust that to see fit. I believe the one today is going to be on lower resolution at 100 kilometers per node. But then it also has any points of interest, like ports, also exist in that graph as well. And then agents spawn onto that graph, in this case, ships. And then those ships can choose to go from point to point to generate traffic on it. And we can dynamically call in how many ever ships we want in the simulation. So then over top of that graph, we have a second graph where a bunch of satellites exist orbiting over the simulated Earth. And what's going to happen with those satellites is we can put them in all sorts of like Molniya or highly elliptical or polar orbits, and we can have those orbits adjusted and tweaked to simulate different types of satellites that might be in orbit. And we can call in different numbers of them, and we can put different types of sensor suites on them to say, hey, this one's got a SAR detector, or this one's got a SAR and an EO detector, or this one's just doing RF geolocation, et cetera. And then as those satellites orbit over, they'll be trying to do detections on any ships that they might run across that cross their path underneath of them. And then we also have a variety of ground station agents that also exist on the ground map doing collections of things like AIS data. So the beauty of doing something like this, it's similar to a tool like STK or AFSIM, but we can run this in the cloud and we can dynamically call in all sorts of different numbers of agents and, you know, inject behaviors into them to say if they want to wander randomly or go from point to point, to help create like a more dynamic living environment for these things to move around and to create some nice data. And the great part about doing this against synthetic data over real data is that we know the truth locations of everything here for a fact. So when we go to do all of our AI ML like analysis to see if our algorithms are running well, we have a ground truth to compare everything to. And we can inject noise into detections to make things like false alarms and stuff like that occur as well to see how the system handles that. So the data fusion approach that we use once you actually get the data generated into the S3 bucket, here's just a flowchart here. The data fusion approach takes the new data that comes in, which is split into just individual detections and then also tracks. So if you have set of points that make up a track that come in, they automatically get put into the giant historical track database. And then the new detections that are just individual points that we don't know if they correlate with anything yet get punched into a bunch of HDB scan passes, which HDB scan is a clustering technique to try and cluster different points of data together into one single trajectory in this case. We split it into targets that we don't know what their category is. So that would be like, hey, you know, we don't know if this is, you know, a cargo ship or a tugboat or whatever. We just know it's a ship, but we don't know what type. And then we also have categorical ones to say like, oh, you know, we know for a fact that this ship is a tugboat because the algorithm beforehand that detected it said so. And we split it up across category to make the data as sparse as possible. So that way the data fusion process can have as easy of a time as it possibly can to fuse the data accurately. And then once it does the data fusion on both the unknown and categorical tracks separately, it tries to take those unknown tracks and tries to best fit them using like a nearest neighbor approach to the categorical tracks to see if any of them fit. And if they do, they'll append them to it. And then once you have all of your new data pulled in and merged together to try and make little mini tracks out of those from the modern data, it will try and take those mini tracks and see if any of them fit to historical tracks that already exist within your database to append to them, or if like a new track needs made at that point in time. And then that gets updated and that process repeats ad nauseum until you want it to stop. It will just keep running as long as it keeps receiving data automatically. So for the actual demo itself, so I mentioned that the synthetic data generator is running on an EC2 instance within the cloud. I'm remote logged into that right now. So all we have to do is we have a Python script here called SymPy Data Agent, because it's using the SymPy Python data library to do the simulated data. And I just have to call on that. And it'll take it probably just a second here to spin up. I believe I have it set to where I think it's going to have 50 satellites orbiting the Earth, split evenly between SAR, EO, and RF geolocation satellites. And then I believe there's going to be 100 ships that's going to spawn in on the ground across the entire world. And then it's going to have those move around from port to port as time passes. So while that's starting up, I'll go ahead and jump into the AWS overview here. So within AWS itself, we have a Lambda function that's defined where the Lambda function is going to automatically trigger off when that data from the EC2 instance is arriving. So that's this Lambda function right here. The Lambda function itself, if you want to like sit here and watch like things happen with it as time passes, there is a monitor point where you can go in and you can see like when the Lambda function is called, when data is arriving. You can see, you know, about a couple hours ago or so, I was running a test run of this to make sure everything was running okay. So you can see that some data was processed in here. And then you can go out, and if you want to see like where the data lands, you can go into AWS and you can go to the specified S3 bucket where everything is being stored. Should be this S3 bucket right here. And you can see that we have, there's a masterdb.csv file that's just being appended to in here, where all the data is being generated. And then the ground truth, sorry, not the ground truth file, the metrics folder has a metrics CSV as well, that records basically like how our algorithm is doing over time in terms of all of its clustering metrics, like adjusted RAND index, vMeasure score, silhouette score, et cetera, to talk about like how separable is the data, how confident is the data being separated, how accurate is it being separated by, how messy is the data in general over time, et cetera. So So the synthetic data generator has started to generate ships and move them around the graph. So you can see here it's saying a bunch of ships are underway, so they're moving around from port to port. And here in a minute or so, you will see within the Lambda function events coming in. You don't really have to look at this in runtime from a user perspective. This is just more so a how the sausage is made type of moment here with the monitoring. But at the end of the day, when you want to look at this in an application setting, you're going to go into heavy AI. So heavy AI is going to take that master database and those metrics, and it's going to pull those in here. And then whenever we go into the specified data files that we're looking at, that those two different CSV files that I'd mentioned earlier, we're going to go ahead and refresh those to make sure that we've got the most up-to-date data from them. That can also be automated if you want to set it up through an API to do it every, you know, X minutes or whatever. And then you're going to see the data come into the heavy AI instance here where it ingests it locally, and then you can start seeing how the data is mapping out. And we can look at all sorts of things here in heavy AI. Here's just a demonstration of a dashboard that I've put together here. So here, like, you know, you can color to different points of all the different types of data that you're looking at here. So all of the data you're seeing on this map is all of the data points that we've generated. And then we're going to color them by the predicted agent type that we're looking at. So in this case, what's going to happen is when you're looking at all the different color points of data here, like when you zoom in, you'll see when you hover over something here, it'll say like, here's the predicted agent's ID number. So that could be a useful number, like an MMSI number, or if it's just like a track, it could be just, you know, a useless number just to keep track of it internally in the system. It doesn't really correlate to anything in the real world, but you can basically go in here and just correlate everything to different predicted agents by color coding them. You can look at the different types of modalities of data that might be being detected. So you can see here that this is a semi-realistic setting where AIS data is, and I guess in a commercial sense it would be like this, is definitely dominating the amount of detections that are being made. It's, you know, it's in the thousands. But then you'd have a few dozen in the SAR and EO domains, and then even a few in the RF geolocation domain. And then what's going to happen is, you know, you have known tracks of the AIS data, and then you're going to do your best to then take the EO and SAR detections that you're doing as well, because you don't exactly know what those ships might be in those images, and try and best match them. The data fusion algorithm is going to best match them to the tracks that you see here. And better yet, you can even go in here, and if you're like, wow, this is a lot of data, you know, it's hard because sometimes ships go back and forth on the same route, and it's kind of hard to see the points, especially when the colors sometimes are so close together because of so many different types of agents. There's a replay feature here that you can do in heavy AI, where we can go ahead and, if we zoom out all the way, we can go ahead and hit play. And it should, as time passes, you can see as it loads here, all the different agents moving around as time passes within the data to show you how things are moving, you know, as each hour, each day, or however you want to bin it passes. So you can keep refreshing this. You know, the data generator is still running. I believe I told it to run for a simulated 3 days of data, and it'll take a while to eventually generate all that data, you know, maybe an hour or so. But eventually, once all that data is generated, it'll stop. And then once it stops, that data stream in AWS Kinesis will stop, which means the Lambda function will stop executing because it runs out of data to fuse against. It's automatic ingestion, automatic generation, and then you can go ahead and view it whenever you want to. So I guess I'd like to thank you for watching this demo. And if you have any questions, please let me know. Thank you.